Can you hear me very well? I don't need a speaker, right? Do I? Okay. Just let me fix my toys. You know, this is just to videotape the lecture. Okay, guys, my name is Dr. Hamza. I am a child neurologist. I currently practice in Dubai and also in Abu Dhabi. I do clinic in Jumeirah Lake Towers, and I do also clinic in Hamlita Medical Center. And it was actually my pleasure to be invited to give a speak. Now, the question I have for you guys, who came to attend this lecture because of the name? Be honest, because of the name. So two, three. Anybody came because of the name? So we did five, but at least we secured five, and that was the goal, six. Good, perfect. Anyone came because of me? You see what's the trick? That's the trick why I elected to use this name. Now, my first goal in the lecture, first goal is I want you to enjoy the lecture, okay? My second goal, I want you to enjoy the lecture. My third goal, if you happen by the end of the lecture to get a useful piece of information, that's fine. I would not be upset about that. The outline, we're going to present the clinical case scenarios. These clinical cases are real cases. I have either seen it in my life during my clinical training, or I heard of them directly from my attendings, or they are a case report. So when we go through a clinical case, and I tell you what is next step, and you'll tell me, you know, I want to put the patient in Abilify, and you get surprised that the patient was started on a tricyclic antidepressant, your answer might not be wrong, but this was in reality what has been done for this patient before. Okay? So don't get offended, okay? If you give the wrong answer. Now, so next step, you are safe. Your chance 25% to be wrong. On top of that, if you are wrong, you are already not wrong, but it was done in a different format, okay? Now, let's go for the meat. Case one. Case number one is a 14-year-old female who started with acute onset psychosis, started 2 days ago. She was noted to have loose association, jumping from idea to idea. Then she was paranoid behavior, okay? She was admitted with similar attack 9 months ago. For 5 days, she was treated with high dose risperidone and Seroquel, then tapered off slowly over a few weeks, did fine. Life was good, okay? Family were happy, doctor were happy. Then, Both attacks were triggered by mild UR. Physical exam, otherwise, is normal. She's a little bit anxious. She's a little bit psychotic, okay? And paranoid, so don't get too close. And otherwise, she's doing fine. So, your next step in management would be, first, I would admit plus antipsychotic medication. Second, I would do brain MRI. Third, I will do black magic EEG. 4, more history, 5, spinal tap. And remember, every time you have more history. I'm not telling you.
URI.
Upper respiratory tract infection. My apologies. Upper respiratory tract infection. Whenever you are faced with more history, in general, 99%, you will be right if you choose that step. So who would go for which? Anybody? We said there's no wrong and the right answer.
More history,
lovely, excellent. So, the patient was admitted, so they ignored the history, and was given antipsychotic, and now she was stable, and her psychosis under relatively good control. Her mother mentioned that she has 3 minor attacks in between, where she was not acting fine, she was not herself, you know, she was like laughing, smiling, and she thought she was out of her norm. Now, your next step would be, I would get CBC, community blood count, CMB, comprehensive metabolic panel, urine analysis, lupus panel. I would do regular EEG because, you know, she had attacks of being not normal in between versus ambulatory long-term video EEG. I would do urine toxicology screen. I would do eye exam, all of the above mafia approach, or who cares?
Who cares?
Who cares? Yes. You want to choose that? Okay, perfect. So who would go for all of the above?
All of the above.
Perfect. Bingo. Right. So basically the world here up, she has two episodes, CBC normal, comprehensive metabolic panel normal, urine was amber color. Amber color, not amber, amber. Okay? And otherwise normal. And here EEG regular and long term. The regular, you do it interactively. 30 minutes, gone. Long term, you put them for 24, 48, 72 hours to try to capture the episode and get more information. Urine toxicology screen. Normal, no marijuana, no nothing. Eye exam was normal. Your absolute next step would be at this time with the. You're not giving a clue. So the only finding is like amber color urine, right? Okay, so that is different. A brain MRI, Huntington genetic test, NCL. Remember, this presentation about neurological diseases who can deceive you and present as absolutely psychiatric disorder. Okay? Now, 24-hour urine collection for ALA and BPG, profilinogen, or spot urine HVA creatinine and VMA creatinine. And NCL is neuronal ciliated lipofuscinosis. Okay? So which one would you choose? If you are in my shoes, what would you choose?
Brain MRI.
Excellent. I love it. For neurology, go for the money. Brain MRI or AEG. Okay? So basically, they did a 24-hour urine collection for her because of the triggered by URR. She has an amber color urine, okay? And she was having two attacks with the unusual presentation. And they find high profilinogen in her urine. Your absolute stat and only diagnosis is fibromyxoma, paraneoplastic syndrome, neuroblastoma, Huntington disease, juvenile Huntington disease, neuronal ciliated lipofuscinosis, acute intermittent porphyria. What's your name, doctor? What would you choose if you are in my shoes? Remember, there's no right or wrong answer.
Okay, first, I want to thank you for starting early before I arrived, because I was looking for the hall. First floor hall on the second floor. And I really appreciate your presence here. And of course, you had an opportunity to read the bio for the doctor. And we're mostly grateful for your enthusiasm, motivation, and leadership in getting things going on time. So this is much appreciated. And now I'm just focused on preparing for the second speaker.
Okay, so thank you for this nice presentation. What would you choose?
Can you answer? Number six.
Acute intermittent porphyria. Okay, let's see what's happening. And remember, this is a real case. That case, I did not put the answer. This is the sequence they did when they saw the patient, okay? The dad, this is like a simple country Jordanian. He's not intimidating. He's waiting for you outside with 20 person with him. So you are not under any influence or stress to give a stat, spot, and only diagnosis, okay? And that's what we call the falcon mustache, okay? Enjoy it, of course. Now, the diagnosis of acute intermittent porphyria was confirmed and interterred. Now, the patient, she was started on antipsychotic, okay? And she was found to have most likely acute intermittent porphyria. As a psychiatrist, how many of you guys are psychiatrists? Psychiatrist, hands up.
Yes.
Perfect. Opiates, I'm asking this question so you guys can educate us. Start opiate, consider alternative medication, and imipramine, start propranolol, tin and zinc, start hematine. What do you guys want to do?
And I think the patient needs from the first in the investigation, we need UDS, urine, drawing, screen.
It was done.
All the scenario may be as effect of Larikin, Nurantin, especially amber urine kind of issue. So my mind,
But in this situation, what would you choose? You have six options. You want to go for one. Your chance of being wrong is 20%, and there's no right order. So what exactly they did, and I will tell you, you need to focus on the first two options, okay? And they always go for the first, so they stopped the antipsychotic because this can exacerbate the finding in case with the porphyria, okay? And they start the chlorpromazine, and clofazimine, I think, to reverse if any problem caused by the antipsychotic. Okay? Now, a few words about acute intermittent porphyria. I'm not going to be the dead horse. I'm going to give you just a few words about it. They are rare. This is, you want to keep them in the back of your mind, okay? And, you know, just keep, you don't know too much about it. It's, you know, the acute intermittent porphyria is the most common of the four acute porphyria. It's caused by inherited deficiency of a prophenylenogen deaminase. It's an autosomal dominant. Acute attacks are usually associated with one more exacerbating factors like URI. And if you look at the symptoms here, what we had urine darkening that is present in 75%, and also mental changes or psychosis is present in 40%. So the patient, you know, pure present with a pure, you know, psychotic disorder. Now, they looked at this patient, and you can see here, you know, the anxiety depression in 55% of the patient, and the comorbidities, you know, the commonest cause of neurologists we see is peripheral neuropathy. And we used to work them as this, and it was not fun to work them, these guys, because sometimes we have to do, you know, tedious, you know, collections. Now, that is what we had, is acute intermittent porphyria, inherited, you need to do the increased level of alanine, delta aminoglobulinic acid, and prophenylenogen, okay? And this kind is one of the things, of the diseases, as neurologists, I'm not saying I'm a psychiatrist, you know, when they present with the psychotic disorder, with a hint, we always look for that, especially if they have peripheral neuropathy. Now, treatment, hematine, opiate, non-steroidal, this is a study done to see, based on the presentation, remember, and sometimes they present with abdominal pain, so I might give them morphine, right? Sometimes they present with psychosis, I will give them Seroquel, okay? So based on the presentation, they found out, you know, hematine in all patients was reported to be very effective, and opiates, then non-steroidal, but this is based basically on the presentation of abdominal pain, okay? So acute intermittent porphyria is one of the things you need to keep in your mind if you have a patient with acute intermittent psychosis with atypical features. We'll talk about this later on. Okay? Urine collections. We'll go for next case. Now, a 12-year-old boy admitted with major depressive symptoms and anxiety. That is, he fulfilled the criteria for major depression with no psychotic features. His vitals were normal other than mild tachycardia. Family history was positive for death of his paternal and grandmother with dementia at the age of 52. In physical exam, he was anxious, flat facial expression, okay? He would not care about anybody. And otherwise, his exam was normal. Your next step, and this is, again, it's a real case. It's not what I decide. Start him on imipramine, 10 milligram BOTID. Start him on Abilify, start Zoloft, hydroxyzine, and Prozac. I can use either one of these depending on my preference. You know, these all can treat, you know, depression, anxiety, you know, but depending on your preference. So I would go with 5, huh? I can use either one, depending on my preference. This is what I would do.
Zoloft is the best.
Perfect. Now Zoloft. Anybody would choose another thing? A psychiatrist. Okay, so what they did, they put him in amipramine, 10 milligram POTID, responded nicely. They did head CT scan, you know, this was in the presentation, it was normal. 1 year later, Oliver. The same guy presented with suicidal ideations, increasing violence, total insomnia, and delusion of persecutions. He completely stopped eating because he thought he was being poisoned. In the previous month prior to his admission, he was noted to be more aggressive at time with episode of mutism and head back. Now, with this presentation, we have one episode, and then second episode, you know, a changing of the psychosis. Your next step, get more history and physical exam.
Fine.
Brain MRI, EEG, start him on hydroxyzine to help him calm down, 1+4. History plus calm down.
Yes, 5.
5? Okay. Who would go for 5? Hands up. I think now we can start Dr. Zera Balloum is here. Welcome aboard, Dr. Zera Balloum. Okay? And Dr. Dina also, welcome. So we'll start here at 5. Okay. Exactly did what they said, what you guys said. They got him Atarax, and the second day he was not to be calmer, and his exam was positive for dysarthria, generalized hypotonia, bilateral pseudoparetic gait with small steps without arm swinging, reflexes were increased, diffuse, and symmetric. So we have now neurological symptoms. 9 months ago, the patient was absolutely completely normal. Now we have a neurological symptom, right? Your next step, urine toxicology screen, plasma copper and ceruloplasmin, brain MRI, neuronal ciliated lipofuscinosis, lysosomal panel, looking for, you know, nemalgic disease, cough disease, or all of the above MAVI approach. Who would go for all of the above? Who would go for none of the above? Okay, it's not an option. Okay. All lab tests done were normal. And they did the MRI and the CAT scan. And as you guys see the MRI and CAT scan, Dr. Dina, your special interest, MRI and CAT scan. A spot diagnosis looking at the MRI and nothing but the MRI, okay? Your spot and stat diagnosis is Wilson disease, cough disease, limbic encephalitis, Parkinson's disease, juvenile Parkinson's disease, PARC1 mutation, or Huntington's disease. Dr. Zainab, I'm very happy to see you today. What would you choose, Dr. Zainab? Okay, so Dr. Zainab, if you look at the MRI, this is a T2 MRI, you know, fluid is white, brain is dark, okay? And this is also T1, and this is, you know, HCT. If you look here, there should be something here, bulging. If you happen to look at the MRIs, it's called caudate nucleus, and it's the flattening of the caudate nucleus. So this diagnosis, Huntington disease, extra-renal. So this is diagnosis Huntington disease. This patient presented with acute, with pure psychiatric symptoms, and he turned out to have Huntington disease. That's patient we have seen in our practice. They do see AG repeat, okay? And you know, when they did it, it is 73. This is consistent with juvenile Huntington disease. It is autosomal dominant with high penetrance, with lionization, you know, every generation present earlier than the other one, okay? And the symptom depends on how many repeats do you have. I remember when we used to go to the Huntington Clinic in Ohio State University, the physician would not give the answer unless the patient has somebody to drive him home. Because it's a disaster. Once they tell you that, you're going to be dead sooner or later. We're all going to be dead. But not like within 5 or 4 or 10 years. And the saddest case I have ever seen in my life is a kid who around 6 or 7 years old, diagnosed with juvenile Huntington. He was symptomatic, and the mom all that time was very not supported because she was in denial. So that disease is a disaster. Okay? Now, the patient has hyperreflexia, gait abnormality, small, shuffling gait, right? Just like Parkinson's disease. He was anxious, he has delusions, and cognitive and behavioral dysfunction. Look, clinical feature juvenile, different than the classical one, because they have bradykinesia and rigidity, this is a classic presentation of Parkinson, and they have cognitive and behavioral dysfunction.
Now, chorea also different, the chorea that you know in the adult main symptoms. Here there is no mention in the clinical presentation.
Chorea?
Chorea.
No, he did not have chorea. That's the neurological disease, okay? Now, this is a patient who, this is a real point by a patient who has depression, okay? And this guy wrote, you know, about his own depression. Sometimes we treat patient, I see 10, 15 patients in my clinic, next, and we tend to forget about how this patient suffers. So this patient would tell you, feel broken down, my body aches, my heart bleeds from my past mistakes. Probably he was doing some drugs. Can't stop the tears, they fall like rain. The words are spinning around my brain. So scared and feeling so alone. The coldness fills my every bone. No food, no sleep, can't think at all. Each way I turn another goal. This darkness haunts my very soul. My world seems dead, I have lost control. The only weapon is my pen. Depression start moving in. This is just a touch of sadness in the psychiatric disorder. Okay. Enough?
Good news? Enough sad music.
Huh?
Enough the sad music.
Yes, okay.
We want something happy.
Tissue? We need tissue? Can I have tissue? Okay. Now let's go back to business. Case 3. And this is a case I was told about it from my my doctor. Did you start to look at the clock? I will speed up. 15-year-old African-American boy with long-standing history of irritable mood depression. He was stable on Abilify. He was in Walmart trying to steal. They hunt him down. They put him in the prison. And in physical exam, he was looked calm and normal, as usual. And for his aggression and for his stealing, what would you do for him if they ask you? Add clonidine to help decrease his aggression. I will consider another medication like Seroquel. He's in Abilify. I need to increase his Abilify. Refer to psychotherapy, any of the above. Any of the above? 5 minutes? I just started 5 minutes ago. Okay. So this patient, basically, they decided, you know what, this is not unusual for inmates to have to be you know, aggressive and to have, you know, this episode. So they put him on what? They put him on clonidine. He got an argument with people and developed, you know, opposition behavior in the prison staff. And his aggression was getting slowly worse. So what would you do next? Consider organic medical cost. This is not unusual for a patient who has, you know, who is in the inmate. They have a lot of troubles. I would do some screening lab and continue medication adjustment. None of the above.
Three.
Okay. We said there's nothing, no right or wrong. Now they decided. The decision said, you know what? The doctor said that's not unusual for inmate to have fighting, to be aggressive. So, you know, change the medication and leave him alone. And then, few months later, he got into argument with the prison gang, and he was beaten to death. They killed him, okay? Right? And when they killed him, they did an autopsy for him, and the autopsy was positive for something. If you were in his physician's shoes, what would you choose? I would have done a brain MRI, probably. I would have done EEG, CBC, CNB, ANA, all of the above, none of that.
Brain MRI. Number three,
CBCCMB. They did everything for him. Everything was normal. This is his brain MRI. Okay? And if you look at his brain MRI, this is Mickey Mouse. I call it Mickey Mouse for kids. You know, this is the cerebral peduncles, high signal in T2. Thalamide, high signal in T2. Okay? So your start on the diagnosis would be for this patient, basically what? If you have abnormal signal with these symptoms, I would do CAG repeat, Huntington, NCL, lysosomal bundle, copper, and cerebellum, and all of that. I would choose number probably with these signals. They are well known to happen in Wilson. I would choose copper and cerebellum. So this patient had Wilson disease, and because they did not pay attention to this guy, and his behavioral problem was due to Wilson disease, he was beaten to death and died in the prison. You know, it's an autosomal dominant, and it's caused by ATB7B mutation. Okay? When this is, you know, a scoring system, how to, you know, to score it. The key point of this case, basically, keep in mind, Wilson can present, like, you know, as a pure psychiatric disorder. Okay? Now, last case, all right? 18-year-old young man admitted to the psych unit, and they have seen this case in my life. He was crying, he was very sad, he was psychotic, paranoid, crying, with a visual hallucination. He was saying, please help me, they're attacking me. They brought him in a cage, and he was so psychotic. Visual hallucination, okay? And he was given a clonazepam the first time, and they gave him also Seroquel, did fine, went home, and in 2 days, he went back to baseline. He was having visual hallucination, right? Your next step, continue current medication, CMI's outpatient, MRI, urine toxicology, all of that.
Urine toxicology,
brain MRI was done all the way north, okay? This was done in reality. The patient was sent home, he did fine, seen 2 weeks later and was stable. One month later, he had another attack with similar symptoms and was brought to the hospital. He was given Haridol, and in 2 days, he went back to his baseline. Father mentioned sometime when he's sleeping, he would be crying. He shout at night. Then go back. Okay? So what would you do? I would do EEG. We did that. Now, with this piece of information, what would you do? We did the EEG was normal, serum cover normal, CLG repeat normal, all of the above were normal, okay? With this piece of information, crying at night, he was doing fine. All of a sudden, he would come with a visual hallucination, okay? I keep submitting. What would you do now? Long-term EEG monitoring study, and Dina is not allowed to answer, VEB test, nerve conduction and EMG, ELG, all of the above. Mafia approach.
Two.
Who said two? Perfect. Any other? Would anyone would go for one? Dina, I told you, you're not allowed to answer. So luckily, they did the video EEG. Which video EEG means? I put the patient, I hook him up to the video, watching him, I put him in EEG, and I monitor. Now, and this is what they cover. Said like this,
yeah.
In the middle of the night, okay? And what he does, the patient. See the video? That's what he's doing at night. They caught it. Luckily, they caught the episode. And they did the EEG. You know, this is the normal. I'm not going to go into detail. This is, you know, abnormal rhythmic activity in the parietal frontal area, front parietal area, okay? Your diagnosis now is what? That's the case of postictal psychosis, okay? And, you know, the criteria, there's a criteria developed in 1988. This is the only one, the criteria I can find. If anybody aware of any new criteria, let me know. But this is the only criteria I know about postictal psychosis. You get a seizure. Sometimes the seizure, you know, that you can stare, don't answer. Then 2-3 weeks, you get a psychosis. Okay? So this patient had a postictal psychosis. He was put in seizure medication, and he was doing great after that. Okay? Now, what do I? When do I need to consider? You know, I have seen a lot of depression, anxiety, psychotic episode. When do I need to consider? You know, something that is fishy, huh? One. Yeah. Although you need to look for all these signs and symptoms in title time. You need to do this as a you know baseline for all psychotic, and you need to do the brain MRI EEG depending on what do you suspect. If you have any atypical symptoms, this is the approach you can take, and we can send you the presentation, guys, okay? Because we are very tight on time. And if this is, you know, another you know journal, another you know author who suggested this approach to do in patient with psychiatric disorder, okay? And they are focusing a lot on the vertical gaze for Niemann-Pick disease, okay? Perfect. Now, I will probably finish with that one. You know, this is a poem I made myself, okay? I moved from medicine, then I started doing poems, you know. They never invited me to, you know, to Shahr al-Arab or something like this, because it's in English. So, and by the way, when I talk here, I want you to pay attention because this every single piece here is indicate a piece of information, medical piece of information. So what I say, what Dr. Rashid would say, I love neurology, love it to death. Without neurology, would not have a breath. Without my neurons, I will be deaf, I'll be confused, I will be stiff. Without them, I will have a useless nose. I will not be able to smell even a rose. Without my neurons, I can't pee, I'll be blind, I will not see. Without neurons, I will lose my mind, I will be rude, crazy, no longer kind. My thalamine are my Wi-Fi, without thalamine, no idea of life. Give me two. Now the thalamine, frontal lobes keep my hope. Without the lobes, I see a dark globe. Frontal lobe injury give you depression. Wow. Cerebral eye held my gait. Without the why, I walk but never straight. Ataxia. My cord keep me a door. Without a cord, never on the road. You will be in the bed. Facial nerves help me blink. Without a blink, I can't have a wink. Amygdalae keep my fear. Without the fear, I love the Zaire. Because I would never be scared of a lion. Because this is called Klüver-Busch syndrome if you injure the amygdalae. Please exercise, keep a healthy heart, feed my neurons, keep me smart. Please do me a favor, leave me alone, don't stress me, I need healthy neurons. Please help me save my neurons, please give me stat value only alone. And that is also in your life. I'll give you the information.
Hamza, may you meet our day. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. wrote in the concept of psychosomatic medicine very vividly, succinctly, and this interesting example. We're really appreciative of your work in this field, and we hope that you will continue to collaborate with psychiatry and on the behavioral aspect of psychiatry. I congratulate you and congratulate Dr. Muhammad Yaman, who was able to recruit you.
Thank you very much. Most he recruited me in fire. No, he did
most
not.
Most appreciate it. And now we continue with similar sort of topics on the same theme with Dr. Sultan El-Shahrani. Now, I'm particularly honored to present Dr.